ॐ जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोः श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः. वी आर मेडिटेटिंग ऑन द ग्लोरी ऑफ मदर दुर्गा. वी आर टेकिंग द बुक देवी महात्म्यम चंडी और दुर्गा सप्तशती एट द बेसिस. This is a most wonderful book. In my last classes, I have been discussing about the inner antarartha symbolism of the first story. As I mentioned, this book has got three stories, one about Madhu and Kaitava. Next one we are going to discuss is Mahishasura, and the third one, Shumbha and Nishumbha. And this book also has got four extraordinarily great hymns. Today's class, we will discuss a little bit, samples only, because it takes many, many classes to complete the whole thing. But we would like to continue the gospel. But I will give you sufficient background knowledge to be able to decipher. So, in our last class, what did we discuss? Before that, every time we open this book, Chandi or Devi Mahatmyam, we have to remember four points. What are the four points? God, with the help of Mahamaya, had created this universe. This samsara is nothing but suffering and troubles, but at the same time, it is also the vehicle of mukti. Therefore, our scriptures advocate the pursuit of spiritual life and reach moksha. That is the essence of every scripture. But this is the fourth point. For attaining moksha, we need the grace of the God, and the grace of God can be obtained only by the grace of the Divine Mother, who is the creator, sustainer, and destroyer of this universe. These four points, if we understand, we have understood the entire summary of all the scriptures. So, what did we talk about in our last class? The story of the destruction of Madhu and Kaitava, how they were about to destroy Brahma and his creative power. Who is this Brahma? Brahma means Vedas. Vedas means Vedanta. Vedanta means Upanishads. Upanishads means each soul is potentially divine. The goal of human life is to attain, to know who we are and become free, called moksha. And there are many paths to reach this moksha or this self-knowledge. But they are all divided into four important categories: Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Raja Yoga, and Jnana Yoga. Sri Ramakrishna specially emphasizes Bhakti Yoga, surrender to God, surrender to Guru, and surrender to especially Divine Mother. So, what is the essence of this Madhukaitava Vadha? We are all Brahmas. Brahma means that we are all potentially divine. Brahma's job is to create. Our job, we are all Brahmas, our job is to recreate ourselves as we are, not as we understand it now. But what is the problem? Obstacles come. Our inherent potential power to do sadhana is sleeping. That also by the will of the Divine Mother. We would like to progress. Something is obstructing. And the first obstruction that comes to us is through these what we call slavery to dualities. Sita, Ushna, Sukha, Dukha. But most important, we are terrific slaves to Slaghana, Stuti. We would like to be admired. Always everybody should say good things about us. Madhu, that will be sweet for us. If anybody, even truthfully, tells us about our defects, we become very angry, and thereby we destroy ourselves. Once when we realize, and we are going to realize at some point of time, then we find we are not, after all, so strong that we can conquer this long cultivated habit of looking for praise and avoiding criticism. These two represent, as I said, all the dualities. Dukkha we do not wish, sukha we want. Shita we don't want, Ushna only we want. Victory we want, defeat we do not wish. We want to be loved by everybody without loving anybody. But that's not possible. So we come to know we are weak, and then we understand this is all under the control of, there is a tremendous power called Universal Mother, Mahamaya. Incidentally, this Mahamaya is also called our own mind or universal will, of which our mind is a tiny part. So if we can call this Universal Mother, recognize her as our own mother, and just to say, oh mother, please take pity upon me and let me come to you, Vidya Maya. And she will take pity. What does she do? She removes the obstruction which is sleeping. The sleeping potentiality awakens in the form of Viveka, Vairagya, Shamadamadi Shatka Sampatti and Mumukshutvam. Through Manushya Deha and Mumukshutvam and favorable spiritual circumstances. Then that we fight, or the Divine Mother fights on behalf of us, drives away Asuri Samskaras, and then our creative power becomes unobstructed and we reach the goal. So there is a beautiful hymn in the very first chapter by Brahma, from Swaha, etc. I will talk about it at the end of this class. So the Divine Mother, in the form of the Tamasika sleep, Tamas means ignorance, departs, bestowing her grace upon us. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Nidra Rupenisam. We are not talking about physiological phenomena called sleep. That is also very necessary. Sleep is one of the most important ingredients of health. If anybody cannot sleep, he cannot be awake, he cannot even dream properly. Our inner potentialities become awakened, and then we rise above this sensuality and be able to realize our true nature, that is Aham Brahmasmi, all through by the grace of the Divine Mother. That is the essence of what we discussed in the inner symbolism of the first story, the destruction of Madhu and Kaitava. Now, straight away we will enter into the second story. This story is concerned with the killing of Mahishasura. Asura. Asura means demon. Mahisha means buffalo. What does it mean? What does this Mahisha really stand for? Terrible egotism. Ahankara. Is Ahankara bad? Not really. There are two types of Ahankaras. Vidya Ahankara, or what Sri Ramakrishna used to call Pakva Ahankara, ripe ego. And Kacha Ahankara, unripe ego. You recollect Shiva's Vahana is bull. Again, that what does that bull represent? Remember, all our gods, goddesses, their weapons, their vehicles, and the beds they sleep, everything has an inner symbolism. If only we have the wisdom to open our eyes. The bull that Shiva rides is, he subdues this unripe Ahankara. Then only, instead of saying, I am Jiva, that is called unripe bull. The bull rides us. We do not ride the bull. But when we have sufficient strength, then we conquer our ego. The ego will still be there. But then instead of saying, I am a jiva, say, Chidananda Rupaha, Shivoham, Shivoham. That is called Pakva Ahankara, Vidya Ahankara, and that is represents man says, and Mano Buddhya Ahankara Chittaninaham, Shivoham Chidananda Rupaha, Shivoham Shivoham. That is the symbolism. Incidentally, I must have mentioned, I do not remember, the snakes that adore are the Yoga Shakti. Shiva is the Yogeshwara and Yogeshwara, both. So, this is the symbolism. Here, Mahishasura, like a buffalo, but is the nature very strong, first of all, and he will not care for even death. That is the first thing. This egotism is the real problem. That's why Sri Ramakrishna says in the Gospel, in answer to a question, when do I realize God? He makes a pun on that word I. He says, when your I dies, you will realize God. What is that I which can be destroyed? That is called Kacha Ahankara, Anraipa Ahankara, Manobuddhi Ahankara, etc. So, this is the story of the rise of egotism, the growth of egotism, and finally the destruction of the egotism. Again, we have to remind ourselves, we cannot do it. Why? Because this ego is not kept by us. It is kept by the Divine Mother. Only she makes the law, she can also break the law. Only she can destroy if we only surrender ourselves to her. But this egotism is not one. It has different manifestations and it has tremendous helps, etc. Egotism comes in many forms, guises, shapes and sizes. Babies have egotism. Just to touch them, scold them, will be facing the corner and say, I will not come, even if they are hungry. A mosquito has its own egotism. But the biggest egotism is to feel, I am a great spiritual sadhaka. Holy Mother used to say this, ochre cloth is the biggest form of egotism. I am a sannyasi, I am a swami. What? Everybody is bowing down to me. This person or these two few people, they don't care to bow down. I will bring down all the curses of the devil upon them. This terrible egotism. That's why when someone asked Holy Mother, why are you not wearing ochre cloth? She replied, Baba, this white cloth is best. This ochre cloth immediately brings about, I must sit on the highest seat. Everybody must rise when I enter. Everybody must bow down. And when I get up, everybody should get up. Until I depart, everybody should be looking at me with folded hands. All these kinds of unspiritual thoughts will arise. Now, the ego, every single second, it is going to change its form, its shape, its power, its manifestation. And that's why Hindu scriptures tell us, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya, lust, anger, greed, delusion, pride, and envy. These are not different and separate enemies, but the manifestation of one and only egotism. When there is kama, desire, then if it is frustrated, it becomes krodha. That's why Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says, kama yesha, krodha yesha, rajoguna samudbhavaha, mahashino mahapapma, vidhi enam iha vairinam. In another place, he adds also, what is called greed, lobha. विशेष त्रिविधम नरकस्येदम द्वारम नाशनम आत्मना काम क्रोध तथा लोभ तस्मात एतत् त्रयम् त्यजेत। सो काम टेक्स द फॉर्म ऑफ क्रोध, क्रोध टेक्स द फॉर्म ऑफ लोभ, लोभ प्रोड्यूसेस मोह, मोह टेक्स द फॉर्म ऑफ मद, मद मैनिफेस्ट समटाइम्स एज मात्सर्य एनवी। वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग, इफ somebody is a friend is having better than either beauty, physical strength, job, money or anything better, even a sofa, better sofa, better children, better car, immediately this multi-headed cobra raises its head, but very silently we smile, oh my friend, how glad I am to see you, but inside we are burning. So that is the power of this envy. That is why Swamiji says mind is restless, because by nature it is restless. Then it is drunk with desire, it is possessed by the demon of pride, and it is stung with the what is scorpion of envy. That is, these are the manifold forms. They could be small, they could be of middle strength, or they could be 100% strong. What do? Bhagavad Gita, we get in the second chapter, Dhyayato Vishayan Pumsaha Sangasteshu Pajayate Sangat Sanjayate Kamaha Kamat Bhavati Krodha Krodhat Sammohaha Sammohat Smriti Vibhramaha Smritir Bhamshat Buddhinashaha Buddhinashat Pranashyati. A sevenfold step to destruction. All because of one primary enemy, which is called egotism. So that is what Mahishasura represents. Briefly, the story is this. In this second story, it is a little bit slightly different, which I will point out a little bit later on. So there was a demon called Mahishasura. He is a very strong person, very stubborn, of indomitable will, and he represents a demon. Asura means demon, as we see in the 16th chapter of the Gita, Daivi Sampat, Asuri Sampat. Unfortunately, the gods represent the Daivi Sampat, but they forgot their Daivi nature, became intoxicated with power, position, and luxury, like Toynbee points out. When these Romans, who conquered everybody, became the masters of the world, they became arrogant, forgot their strength, became slaves to luxury. Even the fruit has to be handed, put into their open mouths. Naturally, they became weak, and these illiterate, uncouth, what is called hordes, tribes, just came and then conquered them very easily, and they in turn became the masters. In turn, same thing happened to them. Then other hordes came. What is my point? My point is Mahishasura is extremely strong, but strength is good if it is used properly. But this fellow conquered all the devas. What does it mean? He never practiced dharma. He trampled upon dharma, and he wanted to do whatever he wanted. He wanted to have the greatest power, position, luxury. He started tormenting everybody. Then the gods, as usual, very funny, whenever they are trampled down, they go and fall at the feet of Brahma, Shiva, Vishnu, and then this time the gods came together, and they pooled their energies, and they gave all their powers, and then the Divine Mother sprang. And then she fought, of course, you know, the power of Mahishasura, though misused, was also coming from the same Divine Mother. So fought means what? She need not, like a physical person, take a weapon and do it. It she just has to withdraw, or like she could put Vishnu to sleep, she also had put this Mahishasura to sleep, he became tamasic, but ultimately he lost. Lost means what? Was he destroyed? Nobody can be destroyed. The soul cannot be destroyed. But the encrustations of tamas and rajas can be destroyed. So that is what happened. The Divine Mother wanted to kill him. There was a battle. And then what happened? This person came, Mahishasura, to fight with the Divine Mother. That means he wanted to fight with his own inner potentiality. How could anyone do that? Because we cannot fight against our true nature, however long we might forget it. So he tried. Then Divine Mother wants to kill, but as I said, this person was expert in changing his shape. Then he gave up his animal nature and became a man. When Mother cut off his head, he became an elephant. When Mother cut off the elephant's head, he became a lion. When the lion's head was cut off, again he appeared in the form of half buffalo and the head was human head. And then Mother cuts off the head. That was the end of the story. That means the multi-headed cobras, all heads have been killed. Even in the last moment, this Mahishasura appears as his head is human head, but the rest of the body is a buffalo head. You will see whenever Durga Puja is done, image of Mahishasura there. Now, what is this? There must be symbolism. What is the symbolism? There are many animals. They have animal heads and they have animal bodies. It is very natural for them to behave like animals. That is the Divine Mother's will. But here are human beings, here are the celestial beings. They forget their celestialness. Humans forget that I am a human being, and outside he will appear like a human being. Inside he is nothing but pure animal. In fact, our body is nothing but animal body. There is absolutely no difference between our body and any animal's body. Ahara nidra bhayamaithunancha samanametat pashuvir naranam. But there is a vital difference. Within, the animals have very little discrimination. They have discrimination, but it is confined only to physical survival, propagation of their species. Most often it ends there. But I also have to add, there are certain animals who also are highly developed souls, fallen into that state, like Jadabharata. Even when he became a deer, he was completely, fully conscious of what he was and why he lost that divine stature. And so next birth, he pretended to be a Jada, a foolish person, a idiotic person. But there are animals who are highly intelligent, who have very well developed viveka, and many are also seen to be great spiritual sadhakas in that forum, so that they will not be bothered by this coronavirus, bhakta virus, and people's virus, etc. Anyway, so ultimately the Divine Mother, he fights with the Divine Mother. That means there is something very important here. If you are fighting with somebody, whom are you going to think about? Are you going to think about Tom, Dick, Harry? Or are you going to think about the person with whom you are dueling? You will be completely focused upon only your opponent. So if the Mahishasura is fighting with the Divine Mother, it is like a baby trying to get angry and fighting with its own mother. And what does the mother do? Please remember this analogy. It is a most important analogy. The mother seems to be angry, she pretends to be angry, and then goes on fighting. After all, if a mother gives one blow, the child may die also. But she pretends that she is giving her biggest blow, but the baby is winning. And ultimately, the mother takes the baby into her lap, and then everything becomes absolutely peaceful. That analogy, the most apt analogy, this is not Swami Dayatmananda's analogy, it is there in the Devas Stuti itself. So, Divine Mother destroys his asuric nature, washes everything of her, of this Mahishasura. That means she converts his tamasic and rajasic ego into pure sattvika ego, which Sri Ramakrishna used to call the ego of a child, the ego of a jnani, ego of a bhakta, or like Shankaracharya, ego of knowledge, aham brahmasmi, I belong to mother, I am Brahman, Brahma Shakti. So that is the end of the story here. So then the devas, they are very, very happy. So this story of Mahishasura continues in the second and third chapters. And at the end of the third chapter, the various manifestations of the egotism were discovered, destroyed by the grace, anugraha of the Divine Mother, and the person realizes he retains vidya ahankara. I am mother's child. I am Brahman. And that is the inner symbolism. So the devas, the celestial beings, here we should not take celestial beings as Indra, Varuna, Chandra. Please be very careful. That state is different state. We are talking about people like what Bhagavan Krishna describes in the 16th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Daivasarasam Abhayam Sattvasam Shuddhi Jnana Yoga Vyavastitaha. So, fearlessness and the complete awareness that I belong to God, I am potentially divine, and I am struggling to manifest my divinity. So many spiritual qualities, Divine Lord Bhagavan enumerates in the 16th chapter. And the people who are consciously practicing those things, they are called the Daivas. That is what we have to see, not this drunken Indra, Chandra, Varuna. In Puranas you will get so many of Indra spoilt many wives of great rishis like Ahalya, etc. So one has to be careful to separate these people, not mistake them, but spiritual people who, because of tamas and rajas, they forget God, they fall victim, soon they realize that they have fallen down and go back to the mother, fall at her feet, take refuge in her, and she bestows her grace, fights on their behalf, and then wins the war for them, and then they regain their spiritual stature, lustre, and go forward joyfully. Now they know they belong to the Divine Mother. These are called the Devatas. So they regained their position, means what? Indra, who lost his Simhasana, did not become Indra. The spiritual person who encountered obstruction in the form of unripe ego, in the form of kama, krodha, etc., overcomes them and then continues his spiritual sadhana. Those who are very near to Brahmadwara, they obtain Brahmagnana very soon. This is how the whole essence is, that do not take pride, take refuge in the mother. Only it is her grace in the form of sattva guna that can advance us along the spiritual path. If we forget her, then she will endow us nevertheless with rajas and tamas, and then we have to struggle a great lot. Now you can recollect how Totapuri Maharaj, the guru of Sri Ramakrishna, forgot the Divine Mother, could not even realize that he progressed and attained samadhi sheerly through her grace, but he did not care to acknowledge it. But in the end, she opened his eyes, then he recognized what she is and joyfully went and joined my mother. Sorry for forgetting you. Now I know who I am, how I progressed, how I attained Brahmagnana. She who can give Brahmagnana can also remove it. That is what we see at the end of this talk. I will try to do that. In the Devi Suktam, so I can make a person Indra, I can make a person Brahma or Mahesha or Vishnu. Everything, it is my divine power. Incidentally, please remember, when God creates, sustains or destroys in the form of Brahma, Vishnu or Shiva, He does it with the help of His Yoga Maya. In other words, it is the Yoga Maya who is important for us, like your immediate manager, upon whose grace your promotion, your happiness, or your comfort in the office lies. So this is the lesson we have to learn. At the end of this victory over Mahishasura, in the fourth chapter, Shakradi Stuti, most wonderful hymn comes. And then, because the spiritual aspirants realize that this is the only way for us to retain our spirituality and move forward. Of course, the Divine Mother, that's what she wants. That's what she was waiting for. So, she becomes pleased and says, please ask a boon, my children, whatever you want. Boon means there are no conditions. Then the Devas, celestial beings, reply, spiritual people, O Mother, you have removed our ignorance, you have advanced us in our spiritual path, so you have done whatever it is needed, like a mother does whatever is needed for the baby. The mother was so pleased, she said, no, I want you to ask some boon. And remember, this is not Indra or Chandra, these celestial beings, the spiritual, sincere spiritual seekers, immediately fall at her feet and said, O Mother, we want one boon from you. What is that boon? There is a possibility that in future also, sometimes we may stumble, like because we are babies, and fall. And when we realize that we are helpless, then we will remember you. Just we will remember you. Smriti Matrena. Then please come. Don't ask for this and that and other things. We are babies, our brains are small, we cannot do anything. We will only cry, Ma, Ma. As Sri Ramakrishna says, the young one of a kitten. Wherever the mother keeps, it stays. But when it is hungry or in danger, it simply says, Mew. And wherever mother is, comes running and makes it safe. So, just by remembrance, you come and remove all our, what we call, obstacles, enemies, everything. Protect us completely like your babies. And the mother had granted that boon. So, this is what had happened. Then, we have got beautiful analogy. Holy Mother says, her commandments are there. That to remember two commandments, very, very important commandments. My child, remember always, you have a mother and I am your mother, not your earthly mother or anybody who brings you up. I, the Divine Mother, is your real mother. That is the first commandment. Commandment, not suggestion. Commandment means it is the highest truth. Do not touch this particular switch. It carries 50,000 volts wire. It's not a suggestion. It's a commandment. Similarly, second commandment. You are my child. Do not forget that you are my child. And live like my child. Behave like my child. Not the child of a pig or a dog or an animal. You are the child of the Divine Mother. You are my child. Behave throughout life like my child. That's what we are reminded of, this one. So this is the second story. Now we go to the third story. Now I said there is something different from the first story. In the first story, the Divine Mother did not engage in battle. She simply withdrew from Vishnu, who was sleeping, and she is निद्रा रूपेण संस्थिता शी सिंपली विथड्रू विष्णु दट ईज टू से द पोटेंशियल पवर ऑफ ईच वन ऑफ अस एवोक उत्तिष्ठता जाग्रता प्राप्य वरा निबोधता एंड दट पवर एवोक एंड देन इट फॉट विथ ऑल दीज ऑब्स्ट्रक्टिव फोर्सेस एंड इट डिस्ट्रॉयड देम or rather very interesting, the demons Madhu and Kaitava give a boon, surprised or pleased for 5,000 years of fight. That means a sadhaka is ready to fight for eternity if necessary. So the other part of the mind, asuric part of the mind, was very pleased. Ask a boon. And then Vishnu, that means our potential powers, positive powers, ask, what else do I want? You let you be killed by me. Then there was a fight, and they kept. What does this killed by me means? Means you give up your asurika pravritti and join. A divided mind, a split personality, cannot be functioning properly. It is insanity. But if we want to progress in any field, not only in spiritual field, we have to join the entirety of our mind. That is called Brahmakara vritti. There cannot be two opposing, fighting, battling vrittis. And that is the meaning of that, let the whole mind become one and then progress in spiritual. Success is sure to come. That is called concentration. That is called samadhi, that is called Brahmakara vritti. Now coming back to the third story, this is a very interesting story. So what happened? Again, the devatas were being troubled, the sadhakas were being troubled by two demons. Both were brothers. Who are they? Shumbha and Nishumbha. What do they represent? Kama and Krodha. That's why, as I quoted earlier in this very talk, Kama Esha Krodha Esha Rajoguna Samudbhava Mahashano. They are never satisfied with whatever food we put into their mouths. That means the more desires are fulfilled, the more we will be moving forward. We want more and more. Like fire is called Anala. Ala means enough. Anala means not enough. So even if a billion desires are fulfilled, the mind will never be satisfied. So like fire, when petrol is poured into it, it is not put out, but it becomes even more virulent. So that is what happens. So the Shumbha, Nishumbha, Kama, Krodha are the greatest obstructions. So they conquered the Devas. And as usual, the Devas were thrown out and they took refuge again in the Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, in the Puranas, here in the Divine Mother. So they remembered, last time, when she asked us to ask a boon, we asked, O Mother, whenever we remember you, please come. And then let us remember. So they repair to Himalayas and they make a wonderful hymn. And then she said, Mother, you promised, whenever we remember you, you come running and help us. Immediately, the mother came, said, do not worry, I am going to help you. What did she do? This time, she became what is called Ambika. She became the Miss Universe, the most beautiful, desirable beauty of the entire universe, not only of Earth, but of the 14 lokas. And then she sat on a high place where nobody can miss her. With her terrible attractive power, each shaking step destroys, O Mother Kali, a world forever, as Swami Vivekananda hymns in the Kali the Mother. So this mother was sitting where she could be noticed, and the servants of Shumbha Nishumbha instantaneously notice her, struck dumb with her beauty, and then they go and report. So this such beautiful lady is there, you conquered all the devas, and they snatched away all their best things, and you are the greatest emperors. You deserve this Miss Universe. Then immediately they said, go and tell her, convey the message, we are the greatest people. So you are the most beautiful lady in the whole world. It is but proper that you should come and marry. You choose either me or my brother, because we love each other. So this fellow came and he says, very Slakshnaya Mathuraya Gira, that honey and butter would not melt on their mouths. This Asura came, servant, and then said, our master took notice of you, and you have been given a choice. You can marry either of them. She says, oh, how great good fortune. This is a little bit of masala by me. It's not there in the Devi. Ah, how fortunate I am. So these greatest emperors want me. That is what exactly I also want. What was this mother doing? She is deliberately producing the sexual desire in them, kama. Already they have, but she is inflaming them so that will be the destruction of both of them. So I am definitely ready, but you know, women are very, very stupid. This is the men's version. Ladies, take notice. Well, women are very stupid. When I was young, and even more stupid than I am now, I took a vow. Only a person who could fight with me and conquer me, I will only marry that person. The servant was aghast. Is it ever possible, O lady? They conquered the whole world, all the gods, and you are abala, means helpless, na bala, bala, abala, and you are a woman, and you are alone. She said, yes, 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 you are right, but you know, as you say, they are very powerful. All that they need to come in front of me, stand, and I will fall down, and let them carry, and then the end of the story. And this fellow says, what are you talking about? You don't know. If you do not come respectfully, we will drag you by your hair. Kesha Krishna Nirdhuta Gaurava Ma Gamishyasi. But she says, I was foolish 100 times to make this fellow remember. Go and report. Let him do whatever he likes. And then they said, hey, a simple lady, young lady, alone, what can she do? But as soon as this fellow came, Hunkarenaiva Basmasatkruti. Simply whom, she said, and they all were reduced to ashes. By that time, Shumbha and Nishumbha, they realized this is not such a simple lady, but they have lost all common sense. So they send many people to cut the story short. They go on sending smaller chip, then a little middle-sized chip, then finally they sent somebody. Who was that somebody? It was called Rakta Bija. This is a very, very symbolic story in the third story that we are discussing. What is this Rakta Bija? He is an asura. His name is Rakta Bija. That means his body is full of nothing but seeds of blood. If one drop of blood anybody sheds by beating him or cutting him, and if it touches the earth, instantaneously another demon will arise equivalent to him in size, in power, in intelligence, in valor, in everything. So first the Divine Mother goes on beating him black and blue, and so much of blood has fallen, and thousands of asuras sprang from there. Now she had to fight not with one, but with so many. Then the devas become very despondent. But the Divine Mother, she says, she called Mother Kali, who came out of Ambika's body. She says, Kali, you stretch your tongue. I am going to beat him. And whatever blood falls, you just drink. That's why we see Mother Kali with an outstretched tongue, trying to hold. Naturally, he could not shed any blood. Blood was coming, but it was all being taken in by Mother Kali. And then finally, Niraktaha. Without any, there was no blood. he falls down, and that is how he dies. What is the symbolism? Bija means seed. Rakta bija means what? Here rakta means kama. You fulfill one desire, I fulfill one desire, and that desire, as soon as it is fulfilled, comes into contact with an object that is called the earth. Immediately, that equivalent, if not stronger desire, a second desire comes, a third desire comes, a fourth desire comes, a fifth desire comes. For example, I want to eat sweet. The moment the sweet touches my tongue, immediately another desire comes. This sweet is wonderful, I want it more. First. Second, it says this sweet is most marvelous, but not to get monotonous or bored, I want a second sweet, slightly different in taste, in flavor, and in many other things, composition. So like that, endless through the pancha indriyas. That is why we say pancha pandavas are five sense organs. And the 100 kauravas, that means innumerable objects of the senses. Life is a constant fight between the sense organs and our mind, which wants to conquer the five sense organs. So this is a fight between sense organs and the sense objects. So the rakta bija, that means if we surrender to mother, mother comes and destroys all the desires, excepting one desire. What is that? I want to be your child. So the rakta bija falls, after that Shumbha dies, after that Nishumbha also dies. Then in the 11th chapter, the devas who are freed completely, and they go on again doing a most marvelous stuti. So this is how the three stories and four hymns will come. Now important thing is Shumbha and Nishumbha. What were they? As I mentioned, they are nothing but manifestations of ego. That is to say, kama and krodha. Now, let us connect the three stories. In the first story, Madhukaitabha means we are subject to all the dualities. We are living an animal life that is killing our inner potentiality. But in the second story, if we are somehow able to kill this, I am a great conqueror, I killed, I am a master of my own body and mind, this ahankara, if without any obstruction, now by Divine Mother's grace, but it doesn't understand the grace, it forgets the mother, and it becomes terribly egotistic, and displaying itself, manifesting itself, in kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madha, matsarya, and all its myriad, what we call relatives, small desire, big desire, etc. Then, of all these desires, the most potent, dangerous desires are called kama and krodha. Kama esha, krodha esha, rajoguna samudbhavaha. In the first story, it is the tamas which overpowered. In the second story, it was rajas which overpowered the vidyahankara. In the third story, it is the manifestation of kama and krodha. It is unquenchable. So, here also Shumbha and Nishumbha represent these things. If they can be killed, so tamas was killed, rajas was killed, and the manifestations of rajas were killed, what remains? Only sattva guna. That is the, so we have to remember there. So, these were killed. And then the devas, as I mentioned, those who are endowed with daivi sampat, they became free to pursue their spiritual life, and joyfully they go forward. But for all this, again and again and again, we have to remember, it is we have to surrender, sarva mangala mangalye, etc. Now the end of the story comes. This was the story, do not forget. Sumedha Rishi was narrating to the King Suratha and the Vaishya Samadhi. He narrated these three stories along with the four stotras, and then he said, so you are remembering those who acted like your deadliest enemies, kicked you out, so that they can enjoy your hard earned power, position, riches, etc. And that is the our attachment to our family members, not only enemies, but family members, etc. Do we have attachment to enemies? Yes, because whomsoever you remember more, that is called attachment. Whom do you remember more, your friends or your enemies? So that is the symbolism. So then this, the Mahamaya is the cause for this Avidya Maya. Again, Mahamaya is the cause for Vidya Maya. O king and O Vaishya, take refuge. Then these three people go and practice intense devotion in the form of self-surrender to the Divine Mother for 3 years. And even they offer the blood from their own body. That means Tanu, Mana, Dhana, everything they offer to the Divine Mother. And Pratyaksham Praha Chandika, a Divine Mother appears and then says, I am very pleased with you. So, what boons you want? And then the king represents what is called a lower intelligence. He has mind control, surrendered to the Divine Mother, but still desires were there. Says, I lost my kingdom, I would like to regain my lost kingdom. Divine Mother says, okay, my child, you will also come to me later on, but for the present you have to play with these toys. I will very in a few days, you will regain back your kingdom. Next birth, you will become the greatest king. You will become a Manu, Savarniko Nama, Manu. So that was how Divine Mother pleased her one child. But Vaishya was a higher type of mind. He was a Jignasu. He wanted to become a Jnani. So as soon as Mother asked, he says, give me that knowledge by which I will never again have to be reborn. And of course, it was the mother's will only. She only appeared in the form of Jignasatva, and she gladly fulfills that you will never be reborn again, because you will know you and me are not different at all. So that is the inner symbolism of this most wonderful. I only mentioned the briefest way that is possible, as we have to resume. Now very briefly, we'll talk about the 4 hymns. In the first hymn, Brahma, Tvam Swaha, Tvam Swadha, Tvam Hi Vashatkaraha, Swaratmika. The way, the very utterance I am able to do, because you are manifesting through my throat in the form of the Swara. And whatever is offered to gods or to the Pitru Purushas or to anybody else, it is only you are manifesting as gods, you are manifesting as the requester, as the beggar, you are manifesting as the giver, and you are only playing in both forms. Sudhatva Makshare Nitye Tridha Matratmika Sthita Tvameva Sandhya Savitri Tvam Devi Janani Para. All the Brahmanas do Sandhya Vandana 3 times a day as Savitri, Sandhya, etc. And that is nothing but Gayatri, Sandhya, Savitri, and all the 3 forms are nothing but, O Mother, yourself. Tvayaitad Dharyate Vishwam. This entire universe is created by you and maintained by you and again withdrawn into you. Tvayaitad Dharyate Vishwam. Tvayaitad Srujyate Jagat. Tvayaitad Palyate Devi. Tvam Akshyante Cha Sarvada. You are Mahavidya, Mahamaya, Mahamedha, Mahasmruti. You are the Sri, you are the Ishwari, you are Hri, you are Buddhi, you are Lajja, you are Pushti, you are Tushti, you are Shanti, you are Kshanti. And in anybody, whatever power is manifested, that's none other than you accepting you. And you put Vishnu, Brahma, Shiva to sleep, and you also make them awaken. It is you who control Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, and this entire universe came from them and maintained by them. Therefore, you are the Adhikartri. That is the what is called essence of the Brahma Stuti. Then 4th Adhyaya we come, Shakradaya. That means Indra and others, as I mentioned, don't take those fellows. It is sincere spiritual people. So, Tam Tushtu Pranati Namrasi Rodhara Amsaha. Bowing down, the him or the mother. What was he saying? I will only take very important shlokas. Mokshardhivihi Munibihi Asta Samasta Doshaihi Vidyasisa Bhagavati Paramahi Devi. Those who are seeking dharma, artha, kama, or moksha, they all have to fall at your feet. You are the only giver in the form of Vishnu, Brahma, Vishnu, or Shiva. So you are manifesting through them. So you are everything. Oh mother, please protect us. Then mother says, so what do you want? So you have done everything, oh mother, but if you have to give, this is the wonderful shloka, samsmruta samsmruta tvam no himsedhah paramapadah. Whenever we remember you, please come. And that is what mother granted. That's what I mentioned about Holy Mother. Then this third hymn, which occurs in the fifth chapter, second hymn occurs in the fourth chapter, third hymn occurs in the fifth chapter. So the Deva said, mother has given us, let us remember. So they go to Himalayas and remember. That is where we get the Divine Mother. They are hymning, you are manifesting in at least 23 forms. So therefore, Namastasyai, 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 Namo Namaha. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu, Chetana, Vidya, Buddhi, Lajja, Kshanti, Kshama, then Chetana, then Matru Rupena, Daya Rupena. So all the qualities we see, including Bhranti Rupena, any thought that comes in anybody's mind is nothing but the manifestation of the Divine Mother. Then ultimately, we come to the fourth hymn that occurs in the entire 11th chapter actually. So, Ekadashodhyayaha. Then after Shumbha, Nishumbha, everybody was killed. Devi Prapannatihare Prasida. Prasida Mataha Jagato Akhilasya. Prasida Vishveshwari Pahi Vishwam Tvam Ishwari Devi Characharasya. Then, interesting thing comes here. So, the Divine Mother says, when you just, my children, remember me and I will come and save you. But there is something very interesting here. The Divine Mother says, my children, always be very, very alert, cautious, always be careful, because if your ahankara peeps out, then you will be destroyed. Then mother, you have killed Madhukaitava, you killed Mahishasura, you killed Shumbha and Nishumbha. Will there be any more? She says, she laughed and said, it is not there in the Devi Mahatmya. I am describing it, adding a little bit mashala. She laughed, my children, this world will never change. The world will always be mixture of good and evil, dharma and adharma, devas and asuras, daivi sampat, and then asuri sampat will be there. In the future also, I will have to come again and again and again and again and again. I will be named as Bhima Devi and then some Durga Devi and so many Brahmariti and all these things I have to say. This is exactly the idea we get in the Bhagavad Gita 4th chapter, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya. If once God incarnates, corrects, brings the balance, that's not the eternal solution. Again, adharma will increase, dharma will go down. This play like a Brahma Chakra goes up and down, up and down, up and down. Then what is the way out? Those who are awakened take refuge in the mother, and then they will get out of this Brahma Chakra. For them, the more rebirth will be there. So the entire essence of this is take refuge in the Divine Mother. This is the only way. That's what exactly Sri Ramakrishna had told to all of us. Then I mentioned, I'll just briefly mention Devi Suktam. It is a quite a big and tough hymn. It is called Sukta. Sukta means Su-Ukta, well-composed. Sri Sukta, Narayana Sukta, Purusha Sukta, Devi Sukta, Nakshatra Sukta, Navagraha Sukta, so many Suktas are there. So it goes, Aham Rudrebhi Vasubhischa Vasubhi Charamyaham Adityaihi Uta Vishradevaihi Aham Mitra Varunova Vibharmyaham Indragni Aham Ashvinova Yam Kamaye Tam Tamugram Krunomi Tam Brahmanam Tam Rushim Tam Sumedha. The essence of what I have just now quoted is, I create Rudra, I create Vishnu, I create Vishwadeva, I create Adityas, I create Mitra, Varuna, I sustain them, I destroy them, I manifest in the form of Agni Devata or Ashwini Devatas. But the most important point is, Yam Yam Kamaye, whom upon whomsoever I wish to bestow my grace, Tam Tam, that person, Ugram Krunomi, I'll make him a ferocious person, powerful personality, or even a devil. So, Asuras are also creations of the Divine Mother only. That is her play. But, Tam Brahmanam, I'll make him Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara. I will give him Moksha. I will give him Brahma. I will make him Brahma. Tam Rishim, I will make him one of the greatest rishis. Tam Sumedham, I will make him the most intelligent person in the world. Echoing the Gayatri Mantra, it goes, Bhurbho Tat Savitur Varehinyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yonaha Prachodayat. I drive their intellects, make them whatever I want. Ishvara Sarvabhutanam Riddeshe Arjuna Tishtati Brahmayam Sarvabhutani Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. I play with this entire universe. There Bhagavan Krishna says, Ishvaraha. Here Mother says, I make everybody. And that's why that Bengali song famous, Shokali Tomari Ichcha, Ichcha Mayi Tara Tumi, Tomar Karma Tumi Koroma, Loke Bole Koriyami. Oh Mother, the whole universe is run by your will. But people not knowing, they think we are running the world. So there also he says, Kare Dauma Brahma Pado. Some people you elevate to the position of Brahma. Give Brahma Jnana. Kare Dauma Koroma Adhogami. Some people you push them by your will. But even when mother pushes somebody down, she never forgets it is her own child. Her pushing down the child is only a play of her. That's why all these asuras and devas, it is a divine play. Brahma Leela. This is a beautiful Leela. And all devotees must participate in that Leela. That let happiness come. It is mother's will. Let unhappiness come. Let mother play with this in whatever way she likes. That's what Mahapurush Maharaj Swami Sivananda used to say. I don't know. Why Sri Ramakrishna has kept this old body? This drum has become very holy drum. Holy means very decrepit, full of diseases. I am just making pun. Holy means so many defects are there. So he is playing with this broken drum. Let his will be done. I am very happy to be beaten by whatever. Ultimately, that is the highest spiritual state. Where we can say, oh mother, everything is thy will, do whatever you like. I know this is, I am your child, I am quite happy you kept me in bliss. So this is a small bit of understanding that I have shared with you. So let the Divine Mother bless us all. Om Sarva Mangala Mangalye Shive Sarva Artha Sadhike Sharanye Trimbake Gauri Narayani Namostute Srishtisthiti Vinashanam Shakti Bhute Sanatani Gunashraye Gunamai Narayani Namostute Sharanagata Dinartha Paritrana Parayane Sarvasyarti Hare Devi Narayani Namostute. May Sri Ramakrishna Holy Mother and Swami Vivekananda, bless us all with bhakti. May we surrender ourselves to the Divine Mother and may we enjoy the lap of the Divine Mother. Jai Ram Krishna.